I want y'all to tell me something. What's a king without a crown? Crown, crown, crown.
Hello and welcome to Saved by the Bell, the Bel-Air Aftershow. This is episode 9. I'm your host, David J. Murphy. Joining me this week are my two co-hosts, Gyasi and Bala. Hey, Gyasi, how you doing?
What's up? What's up? How y'all doing?
Doing great. Doing great. And Bala, how you doing?
How's it going? A little under the weather, but, you know, we still weathering through.
Hey, you know, man, you're making that voice all raspy and, you know, it's working for you, man.
Is that trying new style?
Hey, there you go.
I'm gonna have it's gonna be a new persona, raspy voice baller. We're gonna have a name for it.
Nice, nice. All right. Well, let's get right into the episode. A lot of stuff happened. I was really taken off guard when Will slapped that guy for dissing his girl. I mean, that really took wait. I'm sorry. That's real life. That's the other Will Smith. Yeah, we're recording this right after the Oscars. So of course the real life Will Smith got into a little tussle.
Yeah.
Let's see if Morgan Cooper puts down the second season somehow.
Will slapping somebody season 2, 100%.
Well, he already punched Connor and Carlton in the first episode.
So. Oh yeah, true. But he's gonna something about Lisa. He's gonna do something.
He's gonna be some off color joke about Lisa and he's gonna slap.
Watch your mouth about my Lisa.
Do not use my girlfriend's name in your mouth.
Yeah, it's coming soon. It's coming soon.
Indeed, indeed. All right. Well, let's start with again. A lot of stuff happened this episode. We saw the sort of outcome of Will's desire to get information on it from his dad, from Jeffrey, and kind of how that sort of tumbled into the falling out between Jeffrey and Phil. We saw the quote-unquote debate or lack of debate as sort of Phil made that sort of, I would think, pretty surprised decision to step away from, everything. We saw Viv and her art career sort of starting to really take off and her questioning her desire to even do the scholarship. Of course, great cameos by the previous shows, Viv and Vi. And we saw some of the continued development of Hillary's story, a little bit of Ashley's story. And so, yeah, there's a lot of stuff happening in this episode. And some more continued development between Will and Carlton. But I think we should start in talking about what's going on with Phil's storyline, because his probably was the most integral this episode. So, of course, Uncle Phil got told pretty much straight up, by Jeffrey that, hey, your ambitions are hurting this family, right? You have this constant desire and need for that next big thing. And it's pushing, all kinds of stress on all your family. And it's making it so that they can't achieve the things that they want. So you need to really consider what you're doing. And so he kind of gave Phil the riot act, so to speak. But Phil still fired him, right? Or, supposedly fired him. Steph took a leave of absence. We'll see if that actually sticks now that, things have happened. But of course, they had the debate and Phil decided basically to opt out instead of, him dragging Fred through the dirt and bringing up his indiscretions and Fred potentially bringing up Phil's indiscretions, right? So let's talk a little about that Phil storyline. How do we think about that? Everything from, Jeffrey's interactions to all the way to the debate. What'd you think of Phil's storyline and how sort of this DA quest sort of resolved itself?
I would say so overall I think this was a very solid episode. I think it's towards the top for one of my favorites just because I felt some emotional moments hit and a lot of stuff came full circle as far as like you mentioned Phil's ambitions have kind of been the driving factor behind this season and how certain characters are kind of reacting to what he's got going on. So Hillary's moving a certain way, Aunt Babe was moving a certain way. So I like that, he finally got hit with the truth. Jeffrey literally told a man to man straight up, yo, you're you see your wife is suffering because of this. People are moving certain ways. It's affecting not just you, but everyone else around you. So I like that it came to head. I think I was just talking to my dad literally today about it. I was like, man, this Uncle Phil is he's definitely a flawed man. Like he's not he's not perfect. He's not and I think he still has some growing to do. I mean, he's rough around the edges, but even like, I don't know, he still wasn't totally honest with his wife about, you know, what happened when Jeffrey was like, you know how Jeffrey is with his family emergencies. Like, you know, he had that moment when Will gave him his father's information and said, I don't want to open it. And Jeffrey was like, I feel like that was him, but like saying that y'all can break this together and move forward. But instead, you know, Uncle Phil was like, yeah, you're right. You don't need this. And it seemed like he was still kind of just cover what really happened and wasn't like true genuine with that. So I don't know, Phil. Yeah, Phil is definitely not perfect, but I mean, I do like how he finally got hit with some cold hard truth.
Yeah,
agree. Like I think with this episode, you got to really see everything. It was a cumulation episode. You get to see Uncle Phil really just realizing, is his ambition worth losing his family, or seeing. I think one of the biggest thing that really kind of shined a light was seeing everything because Fred was going to do to win that district attorney role. It was just like, I did this all just to get to the spot. Like, but I also see my family kind of suffering for it. You saw with the whole Carlton situation, with Carlton's anxiety, you see with Viv just complaining, really just making sacrifices, especially after that conversation yeah, last episode. And now you see him going blows, well, verbal blows with Jeffrey. I think, like, especially how this isn't the perfect patriarchal figure you saw with the original Uncle Phil. Like, last Uncle Phil, you had, like, the fat jokes and just the whole hard-headedness. But now you see his hard-headedness, like, and his ambition really is his best and his worst attributes. And I think one thing that really, like, plays out for me is, this Uncle Phil is definitely a little manipulative, and Jeffrey's the only one to call him out about that. I think that's really the work. While Biff can call it out about this, it's more in her self-interest, while Jeffrey's kind of just unbiased kind of opinion, just like, I'm your best friend. Like, I could ride for this family more than I ride for my own family. I've been through some stuff, and I can tell you. And Uncle Phil, you got to see him, instead of being, okay, the loving kind of father he's been this last few episodes, you gotta see, nah, you know your place. Like, and it's just like, dang, he's really been through this. Like, he's really doing this for as without realizing, dang, this has a real effect until it came to Will.
Yeah. And
yeah, like the Will's like whole life and thing could like call and blow is just like, dang. Yeah. But beneath all ambition, family is more important.
Yeah. And then to see him choose his family over him, that was definitely shocking when he dropped out the race. I don't think I was expecting that, but when they told him, like, yo, they have this information, no, you and I was really wondering, I was like, how are they gonna spin this? Because I don't know how this could go, what way this could go. Like, but right. He realizes, like y'all said, like, you know, Will's life would get blown up if this information came out, his new life in Bel-Air. Yeah. You know, his wife is already said she wasn't going to take it, this and that. So he realizes, like you said, like, he's going to choose his family over him. And that was a big moment for him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think.
Dave?
No, I was just going to say, I mean, I think obviously Phil did the thing that he probably thought was the best in terms of not wanting to have the truth come out with regard to Will. Yeah. He knew that Fred would use Will against him because he used Will against Lisa, right?
Yeah.
You know, he presented the information to Lisa, and that, you know, that came out this episode as well. And it was a big thing. We all saw the writing on the wall.
Yeah.
When Will said, like, oh, I'm just here for a better education. Oh, come on. You know, that's going to come out. Lisa's going to get mad at you.
Yeah.
And now we begin the off again, right? We were the on. Off, on, off. We're going into the off phase again. Eventually, they'll come back together next season, of course. They have to.
Yeah.
Yeah. What? It's going to come. It's going to come without a doubt. But I think the two things I would say is, like, A, how big is this gun charge really? Because I know, like, having a gun is definitely, and dealing with the police is always a big thing, but he didn't shoot it. Like, at most, he pointed at, like, the drug dealer. So I'm thinking, dang, okay, he's going, like, to have 25 life type of energy. Like, that, yeah, I feel like it was made a bigger deal than it really is, just to like a criminal more than he actually was.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's probably blowing it a little bit out of proportion, but I don't know. What is the, how long do you go to jail if you have an unlicensed firearm that you shoot in a public area? You know, I'm sure that's not, I mean, that's not like for nothing, right? That's not like, oh, don't do it again. Slap on the wrist. You know, I'm sure there's a little bit more to it than that, but I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, there was a comment, the biggest complaint from this episode I've seen so far, that it's always funny because when I talk to my dad about things, when he comes down and he says something I see on the internet, I'm like, all right, I'm like, okay, I see these opinions on the internet, so people can probably sway each other. If my dad says it, he's probably just formed it. He formed it himself. So, but what people talked about, like while I say, why are they making such a big deal out of what Will, like, they're acting like he actually killed someone. But I understand, from the law standpoint, that there definitely would be consequences associated with what he did. But like the way they talk about it in the show, like, yo, they gonna find out what you did. Like the way Lisa's bawling, like, I can't believe you would do something. It's like,
lodge me
now. Like he didn't shoot anybody, and he could easily explain, like, oh, they was jumping my boy and he had a gun, so I just shot in the air that broke up the fight, which is exactly what happened.
Yeah.
That is one complaint I've seen on a lot of social media in front of people. It's like, oh, why are they making this such a big deal? But one thing I didn't totally get was the judge that actually got Will free was the same guy that told his information to Lisa's father. And he told Uncle Phil, like, you get what you got was coming to you. But like,
yeah, the judge broke, is just as culpable as...
Yeah, like, if he broke the law, you're going to... Like, your smoking gun is to out yourself. Like, I was a little confused on the route they were trying to get away with that one.
He's just that dedicated to having Phil win the election. He's
like, what in the world?
Nah.
Or something, I don't know.
Yeah, it was... what's his name? The dude who played Troy Jefferson from the... His character in the old show, just that corrupt ass judge who was just only cares about his public image and making sure he keeps that position in power. But at the same time, it's just, dog, you helped with this. So if he Will's getting put on blast, you're definitely getting put on blast.
Yeah. That's why I was like, okay. Like, I guess.
Next season, Phil's gonna run for like mayor or like governor or senator or president or something like that. Or maybe he'll just do his job as a lawyer. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it is sad to see his campaign end because, like, that was such a prominent aspect of this season.
He spent a lot of money on that campaign.
Bro, I'm not going to lie. I looked back, I'm like, yo, this is just hurts to watch. Like, millions of dollars.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Cool millions, like, on this campaign, all down the floor. Like, that's what made it feel anticlimactic. Like, you made this a big deal. So, I props to you for having this character growth by the same time. If you lost millions of dollars, if I was your like campaign manager, I'll be heated.
Another thing that kind of I feel like was more they showed us instead of what they told us or they showed us was when they were talking about how Lisa's dad and they were like, oh, Jeffrey mentions he's a good man and you're going to crush him in this debate. And how he's like, I'm going to throw all of my support behind him. And it's like, I wish they kind of showed us that because he's just been a straight up like terrible person since the moment he was introduced. Like, obviously didn't know he had infidelity, which, I mean, you know, characters had came back from that in media before, but also like running against his best friend randomly, using Will against Lisa. Like, I don't think there was much redeemable qualities there to make us think, you know what, he could still be a good DA. Like, they should have done a little more humanizing for him instead of just making him a villain. And then this episode telling us, oh, he's a good man, X, Y, and Z.
Yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of like grandstanding there, right? He's saying that for the cameras. He doesn't actually believe it. He's trying to get out of the race, you know, cleanly, so that if he decides to run again, you know, he can, hopefully against someone who doesn't know like the secret, right, with Will. Yeah. And again, it shows him as, you know, being the better man by willing to step down. So it's, again, it saves face for both of them and especially for him if he wants to run in the future, because I think his campaign would be nixed anyways if it got out what he did to work that deal with the judge for Will. just because, you know, again, you want to be a DA, right? So you plan to deal in the world of law and crime. Let's talk a little bit about that Lisa reveal and also the sort of bonding that we see between Carlton and Will this episode. You know, it's definitely like we saw a little bit of that last episode, and it's definitely continuing to develop. Of course, you know, they go to church at first and Carlton has his issues trying to sing, right? And we think he's going to be going to the drugs, and we find out that, you know, Will is now Carlton's drug. And so, you know, there's that really continued bonding. Obviously Carlton has the issues, but Will's there for him. They talk about it, they get through it. And then when Lisa comes into the picture and is trying to accuse Will of whatever, Carlton is actually the first person to step up, be like, Lisa, it's not what you think. You know, of course, Lisa doesn't want to hear any of it, right? Because we have to play into the common TV trope of if people just explain things, then it wouldn't be an issue, right? But what do we think of the continued development of Carlton and Will this episode? Do we like them getting closer together? Is Carlton now redeeming himself?
I wish we had Nolan here
to talk about it, but you know.
Yeah, I know, right? We need Nolan's opinion on this. I thought it was great to see them bond and you know, just see them growing closer as family. I mean, that's always good to see. Shout out to Oli, the actor, Carlton's actor. He's actually a musician in real life, so it was cool. Nice. It's always cool when they get to flex his musical abilities a little bit.
Yeah, like pain didn't have to sing badly.
Yeah,
I could do this blindfolded.
I thought he was doing a good job. You know, he was going on stage singing, but obviously, you know, anxiety got the best of him. So I like that. Yeah. That's still a part of him. I do wonder if he really flushed the drugs. I know he mentioned that he did, and I think he did, but I knew some people on the subreddit were talking like that's not how addicts work. They were like, he probably said that, but next season is going to come back out. So I wonder, but I know as far as their relationship is, I like to see the way it's progressing. Definitely.
Even if he did flush the drugs, I'm sure he can get more easily.
Yeah, very true. He obviously was getting them before.
That should probably comes like so easy. He can probably find a new partner. Just like, can I get that coke? I do think it's interesting that confirmation that he wasn't just snoring Xanax, he was also snoring cocaine. And I think,
I think
what really got me is first when Will mentioned Hillary, and Hillary realized how much do I really know about my brother, because it kind of sees that huge disconnect Carlton has from the rest of his family, explaining why he's kind of a different personality, and also showcasing the anxiety in a bigger fashion in that church scene. Again, props to Ollie for showcasing his sling ability, but also Joe's overall acting, just showing how this anxiety is physically crippling to him, where he doesn't even, and you can see it just bubbling up, building up, which is one thing all these guys are good. They know how to do a like intense build up, like really build that suspense.
Yeah.
And I think one complaint we always had was, okay, this doesn't, how do you make Carlton sympathetic? How do you go from point A to point B of a friendship? And I think the last episode, in this episode especially, did a good job of just building up that whole, I guess, kind of overdose breakdown he had at Lisa's party, or party for the lupus. And now we get to see, okay, how's Carlton deal with recovery? Is he going to, like, go back drugs? Most likely, it's a drama. That's always But I think this episode really get to see more layers to Carlton's character outside of just the self-hating, like, black guy we've seen in before episode. One thing I did say would irk me, though, is how Lisa kind of just sunned Carlton when she was getting all like emotional about the whole Will revelation. I mean, I'm glad I was bros like for Will and Lisa, but the fact that she said, yo, shove Carlton, stay in your place.
Oh, yeah, that was a little wild. In his own house.
In his own house. Like from an ex-girlfriend, like, dang, you just got like cucked or something, my brother.
Yeah, that was a little harsh.
Yeah. You know, I've been listening to the official podcast, right?
And oh, it's great to have. Out.
Yeah, no, it's great to hear from, you know, obviously the director and the guy who plays Will Smith is on there. And so, you know, all the characters and everybody's opinions. And one of the things that they talk about a lot are the costumes, right? The costumes and the food and the set design and all these little integral parts outside of the actors that is really, you know, to put a lot of focus on. And, you know, and of course, at the beginning there, we had the church scene with all the, you know, various hats and costumes and people, way people dress, you know, for church. What did you all think of that? Did you like that kind of representation of that sort of side of culture? Or what was, do you have any thoughts about that church scene in general?
Yeah, it was very, very familiar. Like, I mean, you know, church is very important to the Black community. So this show is definitely trying to be a cultural show and, like, you know, represent the culture well. And I think it's doing a good job so far. So, yeah, I definitely thought it was cool seeing him go and then have Carlton. I like the pastor and his relationship with Phil and everything. I think that's cool.
Yeah.
I was about to say, just harping on that. Yeah, growing up, church is a big thing in both Black, African, just overall Black community, especially with Easter or like the big holiday. It will drive all the way up. Like, the more colorful, like, you're not really going to church. Like, that's basically dedicated to this whole God thing. So I think they really did justice. And especially for someone in Phil's standing, it's all about optics. Like, with church, if you're on your dedication to God, they will really be talking. So church community is Black community. I think Morgan Cooper and the whole crew got that down to a T.
Yeah. No, it's interesting because I'm not a religious guy myself, but it was interesting to see that they represented religion very explicitly on the show, right? Like, you know, they are very much a Christian family and they talk about God and prayer and all that stuff. I don't know. Was that ever discussed on the original show? Did they ever talk about religion or church or God at all? Do you remember that as being part of any of the original series?
They had some church episodes, like Carlton to sing for the big Easter competition. Yeah, Lil Nicky's baptism, where boys to men appear, and
You got a good memory. I'm forgetting about
that. Yo, I told you I just finished rewatching.
Okay.
I wish I could. I mean, I do got a good memory, but like I can't close this time around. And I remember this one episode where Vi was kind of, well, the pastor was feeling the new Aunt Viv, and Aunt Viv was kind of feeling uncomfortable. And that was a whole conversation where Will just like, oh, nah, the pastor's trying to creep with my hand. Like, let me just shut down before Uncle Phil gets into it. So church was a big conversation. Well, not as big as it was here, but it was still a conversation. One thing that was interesting is seeing Lil Ashley try to put her, like, relationship with LGBT community. Like, yo, you got to do a little more for us right here.
Yeah. Yeah, let's talk about Ashley's side, because, you know, a lot of the folks, especially in the subreddit, have kind of pointed out that she's sort of one note. You know, she's kind of like the Gen Z LGBTQIA plus representation character, and there really isn't much more to her beyond this. Do you think that is a valid complaint about the way she's being characterized, or is it just she's a 12-year-old, right? There's only so much depth and characterization you can do with a 12-year-old character in this type of story, right? Like, what kind of storylines do you want from a 12-year-old, right? What do y'all think?
I remember when we were talking about her storyline earlier in the show of recording these, and we were like, they probably won't go too much into this, but they seem to have gone, like, that's been her, like you said, her main kind of plot point since they introduced that idea. So I don't know. I think it is kind of, that is the main thing she's doing right now, or like what her character is about. I would like to see more of, because I wonder, season two is coming soon. I wonder with her character, I would like to see more of her relationship with her siblings, and, like, you know, seeing how does she feel being the youngest in the family? How does she explore? I feel like there's a lot they could actually do with her character, you know, her Will coming in and having like a second older brother, because, which they kind of did a lot in the original Fresh Prince. You know, she was saying like she's closer, like she never had an older brother. He's like, you got Carlton. She's like, just stays quiet. He's like, I get your point. So, like, I feel like they could do a lot more with that. So I don't know. I think the youngest in a big family is I think that's a mindset worth exploring. So hopefully they do more with her. But yeah, I would agree that so far, not much development on her front. I know she's just kind of pushing the plot forward, and her mom kind of wants her to be honest.
Yeah.
Because her mom is clearly knows what's going on.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Or she suspects something for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, she suspects / knows. I feel like she knows, but she wants Ashley say it more than Tyler, yeah. I know you love her, but it's okay, baby. Go ahead, be your bad self. But I do agree that I feel like this has so much time setting up. It's just like, what's more to her character? We had the whole, oh, I went from environmentalist to budding, like her budding sexuality. But I think the biggest thing is, okay, why do you treat a minority character like a minority character? Like, if you have a show with a majority white character, if you have a black character on, is the only thing going to be on black? Like, I can understand where those complaints are coming from. Like, I think it's hard for just general shows to just really catch an LGBTQ character without realizing they're just like else. They might be interested in different people, but they're just like everyone else. So I think it's just trying to capture that with a much nuanced way of feeling like you're checking a list is the main complaint. Yeah. So I do hope season two, you get to go more in depth with a character, like with her relationship with Will, especially, as well as the other family, and probably more of her interests outside of just her sexuality and her like environmentalist issue, like probably what's happening at her middle school, like, How do you feel as someone with your sexuality in a technically more accepted but still like controversial kind of play, especially in the black community? Because I know in the black community there is rampant homophobia. I'm not gonna say we're the most homophobic people, but homophobia is rampant in it. So it would be interesting to explore this thing instead of just saying, "Oh, you're LGBT, you're automatically accepted." Just going through all the problems and pains of being like a teenager, trying to figure yourself out. Like, there's so much in depth. And I feel like they have me barely scratched the surface.
Yeah. And also, not relevant to this at all, but the little girl who plays Ashley is the girl from Captain Marvel. And I did not know that. I didn't realize that. I
know that either.
Called it out. I was like, oh, that's crazy.
Oh, she was the girl in Captain Marvel?
Yeah. So apparently, nice. Yeah. I saw on the subreddit, I think they said, like, in this Captain Marvel show, not in the movie, she has a line that she's like, she says, I can't just stay home and watch Fresh Prince all day. And now she's like in the show.
Right. Cause that movie took place in the 90s. Yeah. Yeah. So that was the time. That's crazy. Yeah.
She's little Monica, wow. Monica Rambo.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Now she's all grown up on the WandaVision TV show.
Exactly.
Hey, her public agent's doing wonders for her. She's gonna be like the black Tom Holland, like everything.
Oh, get out of here.
That's right. A couple of years, black female Spider-Man. There we go. Multiverse, right? You can do anything.
Yes, in
multiverse.
Possibilities.
Her character, or at least her storyline, you know, we thought it was kind of wrapped up, right? She was like, okay, yeah. I like this girl and she doesn't like me. All right, there we go. But yeah. Now we're obviously at some point. They're going to have to do a storyline. Maybe it'll be next episode where she comes out to her parents and her parents react. And I think obviously Viv will be, accepting, and, Philip may be less accepting, but not, overt about it. Right. He may just be like, okay, well, we accept you for who you are, but considering again, how religious they are, perhaps, it might be more of an issue than, he thinks. And maybe that'll be the new struggle for him, right? He struggled with this thing this time. Perhaps he'll struggle with the realization of who his daughter wants to be. So that'll probably be something we either see resolved next episode or develop next season. And, I'm sure they'll go on to other, I guarantee she'll be the focal, the focal point for any sort of, beyond just environmentalism, every sort of issue that is relevant to, this group, I think she will be the focal point for it, or the generator of it. Right. And it'll be interesting to see how her character develops in future seasons. Cause she's got a lot of growth to do. Right. I mean, I wonder if this will be something to where, each season is a new year. Right. So we follow the family, the kids and Will and Carlton as they, next year they'll be seniors. And then the year after that, they'll be in college. I wonder if we'll do that, or like each season will just be a few months over the course of a year, right? Like, I think they'll just compress time. And then of course, Ashley will grow up to be an 18-year-old and over the course of 3 months or something like that. So
I was reading a theory that they're going to because they may not want to take him out of high school so soon. So they may do the summers. So season two may be over the summer. Mm-hmm. And then maybe the third season is the next year in school, X, Y, and Z. So I wonder how they're going to do it. because depending on how long the show lasts, you know, we will see little Ashley grow up and the actress, just like we did in the original Fresh Prince. Like, you know, she was so young, you know, watching it, and then Ashley becomes like a full-fledged adult. So
I hope it goes like at least a full 5 seasons, you know, to syndication and whatnot. I think that would be
fire,
you know, doing the original
hard show to justice. Pull off on streaming. Very hard to pull off on streaming.
It's two to 5 seasons.
I think it's tough. Especially now in the streaming world, like shows get canceled so fast.
True.
Single. Well, singles. What I was gonna say is, I feel like they're gonna like keep Will in high school as long as they can before moving him off to college. So I feel like it'll be like 3 seasons of him in high school before moving to college. But who knows?
Well, he went to college. Did he go? Did he go to college in the original show? Or was he accepted to college at the end of the series?
No, he went to college like when they switched out Aunt Biz.
Okay. So I guess then he'll go to a local college so that he can still live at home and interact with all the banks.
They have to have Bel-Air in there somewhere.
Can't take the Bel-Air out of Bel-Air.
That's deep.
That's very deep.
There you go. Quote unquote. Put that on the box art.
Dave is a like philosopher.
Let's talk a little bit about Viv, because she had some pretty good story progression this episode. Mm-hmm. Obviously, she had her meeting with the art directors for the scholarship, and it was just a really neat kind of reunion. We saw that picture that looked like Uncle Phil, right? That ode to Uncle Phil photo or graphic.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, rest in peace. First things first.
James Avery.
Indeed. And then, you know, of course they had the meeting and Viv was just taken aback by, you know, the fact that, oh wow, Black women are talking to another Black woman about this. And then, you know, of course Viv has the sort of, can I do this, you know, and they say, oh no, 24 hours. It's a good thing they waited 24 hours, because, you know, next episode she'll probably be like, okay, I'm good, my husband's no longer doing the thing. So what do we all think of, you know, Viv's continued storyline, the art storyline, and how things are progressing there? It's pretty interesting, eh?
Shout out to cameos. We finally got some original.
We got that Patrick George moment. We're here for it. But you know when it's real? When we get Janet like on the show.
Oh, the original. I was thinking that. I remember Dave had mentioned like later, like maybe the first couple episodes, he was like, he could make it up to her by bringing her back.
Yeah.
So that would have been cool for her to play that role that we saw the new Amvin play. But I did see Janet post on Instagram yesterday. He was like defending Will. So it seems like they're in a good spot, because, you know, a couple years ago, she would have never defended him.
Right.
She was bashing him for years. But she was like, you guys understand, like, his wife is being, you know, blah, blah, blah. So she was defending. So maybe he's going to throw her a little role in here. Maybe she'll play a different character. We'll see.
Maybe he needs his defenders, because too many people defending. I think. I mean,
yeah,
it's definitely interesting on Twitter about that whole thing.
Oh my god, it's so funny! Literally, the discourse on Twitter versus like the other social media is so crazy. It's like a stark difference. But yeah, as far as Arvin's story, I mean, I think she needs to take this. I like that she's finally getting back into her art. And she has crazy opportunities. And I think, it was a powerful scene when she was like, she calls and she says, you know what, there's too much going on in my life right now. It would be selfish of me to accept this. And then they're like, nah, like you said, wait it out. And then, so I wonder how much from a writing standpoint, they talk about her accepting, since like, okay, press tours, X, Y, and Z interviews. You're not going to be there, but obviously she has to be on the show. So I wonder, season 2, are they going to go the route of off camera? Like, I just got back from press tour. Or are we going to see her journey on this art journey, you know, away from the family?
I think we're going to see that away from the family. Cause I mean, they have to show her and Reed getting closer. Right. I mean, that's, you know, whether it's real or fake, there's going to be definitely some sort of,
you think Reed's coming back?
Oh, absolutely.
Michael Easley.
He's gonna be like, yo, I gotta be your tour manager or something. I don't know. I don't know what art dealers do.
You can't set up like that whole like, well, they won't they, like, yes, like from the side do and not just show anything out of it.
Yeah.
I can see it coming back.
There has to be some more temptation there, right? Even though I think she's probably like enamored. You know, I think she's totally on board Team Phil. You know, I don't think she's gonna.
Yeah.
And now that he's made that sacrifice for her, I mean, he's making, you know, strong strides towards showing his support to his wife.
But how much more can she take from Phil if she finds out that? Because think about it. She told Phil, I think, you know, we should tell Will about his father. And he was like, I don't agree that this should be, we should go this route. And that, you know, that's a normal couple conversation. But Phil goes the extra mile and pulls Jeffrey and says, hey, I need you to make sure Will doesn't know about his father and doesn't involve his wife in this conversation or his decision at all there. So
yeah,
that's
yeah.
one thing. If she found out about that, she's like, okay, you literally went directly against my suggestion and
yeah.
made sure it will never happen. So that's, but then that's in the past. But then now we have, like I mentioned, Jeffrey, who's obviously a part of the family, has been there for years. That's his brother, right. is fired by Phil
yeah.
for this very thing that he then tells Aunt Viv that, yeah, he had a family emergency, so yeah. you know, he had to go. And she's like, wow. So I mean, he's still going kind of behind her back. So I wonder how much more can she take. Is it gonna come to terms and they're gonna maybe separate? Who knows?
Yeah. Do you think that the firing of Jeffrey is gonna actually stick, or do you think it's like, you're good? I don't think he's gonna be out of the series. It'd be pretty weird to have a
yeah.
Fresh Prince show or a Bel-Air show without Jeffrey, right?
I was about to say, especially as Jeffrey, like, dang, you can't do all
bro.
That. This man's a like bone collector. Like, you can't fire the bone collector and not like keep him gone.
My very bad, like, unrealistic, terrible writing theory that we'd be cool to see is not even theory because it never happened. But I thought it'd be funny if, like, you know, some feels or not feel, but will someone's in jump, someone's in trouble. It's like the TV shows or the movies, something's about to happen. And Jeffrey just comes out the cut he was watching the whole time, stops the fight, beats up a couple guys. And it's like, yo, he's like, I never stopped watching y'all. And it's like, yo, like last moment save. I could see Jeffrey doing that. Like, Phil's about to get jumped or something, gun pointed at him, and Jeffrey just comes in, gun swinging.
I think the new security guard Phil hires will be, you know, some bad dude, and Phil and Jeffrey will find out.
Oh yeah, that'd be a good plot line. That'd be a good plot line.
And that's how he earns his good graces back into Phil's heart.
I don't know if there's any error rosters, but I need that John Diggle and a Jeffrey crossover. Like
John Wick, Jeffrey.
John Wick too. Like John, yeah, John Diggle, Wick and Jeffrey. Like
John Diggle, John Wick, and Jeffrey. Crazy trio.
They've had John Wick, I think in John Wick 3, he worked with a sort of pseudo partner for a period of time. So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely. He can come in John Wick 4. That'd be great.
But yeah, but Jeffrey's definitely not out the show. I mean, he's a main cast member. He'll be back, whether it's him exploring his relationship with his son or, I mean, Phil's going to realize that it was a raise and get Jeffrey, yeah. right? No one else he can trust.
Yeah, I feel like it's either going to be Will seeing his father, or Jeffrey, like, coming into terms with his, like, relationship with son, or Will or someone getting jumped and Jeffrey just coming back and just come and sleep real quick. Like,
right.
Jeffrey's not going to be gone for long.
We'll just hear a couple shots ring out from the distance and Jeffrey will snipe all of the bad guys. All right. Let's talk a little bit about Hill's storyline. Kind of developed a little bit. We saw Jazz come back into the frame, right? And they're kind of, you know, coming a little bit back together, hanging out a little, getting real friendly with one another. So, I mean, definitely there's that relationship could be developing again in the future. They definitely put that out the possibility. But I think Hill is doing okay for herself, considering she owes like $50,000 to Kylo, right?
Yeah, I mean, let's talk about the big thing from that scene, which was when... Jazz is like, you know, come through, I'll cook for you, let me
yep.
spend some time together. And she's like, oh yeah, man, let's go to Four Seasons and get some takeout. And you can see on his face, it's like he obviously cares about Hillary, not because of the money, not because of who she is, not what she is, but more like who she is. So he wants to show her that, you know, he's not gonna ever be that where he can afford the Four Seasons night. So right. he wants to show her that he still has, not even still has value, but he cares about her and that, like, she wants to love him for him. So I saw the pain in his face, but she's like, nah, let's, I just go to four seasons. Like, of course, that's easy for her to do, and she doesn't think much of it. But for him, that's not like who he is, and it's definitely not what he's gonna be able to offer her. So I thought that was interesting, you know, how they planted that little seed there. Like,
I'm not gonna lie, that threw me off because I was like, you talk about four seasons, but you owe $50,000. Like, priorities aren't like really there.
Yeah.
Like, how about you not stay at the Four Seasons a few weeks, and then you can pay off your debt. There you go. Yeah, that is interesting to think about. I didn't think about it like that, you know, that kind of the class difference, right? And I mean, yeah. Jazz is very much like a down-to-earth, like, regular guy. And obviously, you know, Hill has lived this sort of gilded life her whole life. Yeah. And it's like, that's going to be a real tough thing for them to, you know.
Yeah, I think if they're going to score further, yeah, you're right. Exactly. There's going to be an adjustment for both of them, and more so for Hillary, because she doesn't realize, like I said, like, Jazz wants to show that he is enough. Like,
yeah,
she has to accept that. And it's hard to do that four seasons every night.
Yeah.
Because I think the thing is, like, Hillary's trying to be self-made. You can see in her personality, he's overall, that she's always trying to do herself. She's trying to make her own way. But you can also tell she's used to a pampered lifestyle. She's used to getting her way. And she's used to, even though she's outspoken, she's also, I think one of the first conversations, Will, you can tell she's very bougie.
Yeah.
While Jazz is what we call get out the mud. He has his own Uber company. He got a record shop from his family, mm-hmm. but he's working it. Like, he's all about personal connections and all about his pride. So I think that's going to be a whole conflict itself. While Jazz is trying to be Mr. Coco Jones, like, he's out just trying to be like, dang, how much is going a male ego.
Yeah. No, I mean, Hill is definitely a great character, and, you know, she's very interesting to watch, but there's also a level of maintenance that comes with someone who is, again, coming from that background, right? Like, I know rich people, and they expect certain things, right, in terms of the things they do and, like, the amenities that come with what they do, like eating out all the time or going to nice restaurants or going to nice hotels. And Jazz might struggle with that. He may be like, I have to now, you know, spend all my money and, you know, all this stuff that I'm trying to, like, scrape by just to make you happy. And it just might be too much for him unless Hill is willing to kind of, you know, go down to his level a little bit.
Yeah,
you know?
Meet in the middle.
Yeah. So, no, that's interesting to see how that will develop.
Yeah, I'm curious. I mean, I like the direction that the show's going with their relationship, though, as far as they I feel like they have good chemistry, you know, so far. They definitely. And Jazz is still the GOAT character.
The chemistry is immaculate. And it's just like, separately, they're fire characters, but together, just like, that's a beautiful cup. Yeah. But the thing is, Hillary is a Benny Hondens type of girl, while Jazz is like, I'm trying to go to, like, In and Out Burger. I'm trying to go. Churches real quick, what you talking about?
Yeah.
No, I do like to see them together. They do make a good couple and a good on-screen couple. I do wonder when we're gonna have another scene with Jazz and Will together, though, right? You know, they haven't talked about
that's true.
They need to talk about Will's dad.
Oh my god, Will's dad. Are we gonna get into it?
Might as well. Let's talk. Do we talk about all the major storylines? Is there anything we didn't mention from this week's episode before we start talking about predictions?
No, you covered everything.
I think we got, I mean, Jeffrey leaving, you know, that was big.
Let's talk about that quickly, since you mentioned Jeffrey, the Jeffrey and Will interaction, when Jeffrey gives him the packet of papers, right? Mm-hmm. Says, you know, Will's like, should I look at this? And Jeffrey's like, hey, it's, you know, it's your decision, but it's going to change things in the house. Do you think Jeffrey was right to do that? Should Jeffrey have sort of given him the warning, or do you think Jeffrey should have just said, yo, just look at it, you know, and then you figure it out? Like, because that kind of was the catalyst for Jeffrey getting fired, essentially, right?
Yeah. And I, one thing I want to mention about that, I've seen people saying, oh, why would he betray? They think Will betray Jeffrey or something by giving it to Phil. But yeah, clearly Phil, I mean, Will had no way he could have known that they were at odds about that situation, or that that was even a problem from Phil's side of view, that, you know, him finding out about his dad. So,
right.
But I think he was right to give that warning, because sometimes it's like, there's a thing called, like, I forget what the actual term for it. I studied in school, but it's like, people are ambiguous information, like uncertainty, and like more certainty causes more anxiety for certain things, for certain information. So it's like, you know how when you get an email, it's like, I don't even want to read this email because I don't want to know the result, like whether it's a test or something. And it's like, at that point, the more information you have, you think you'll be less anxiety, but it's the opposite. Like, it causes more anxiety because now you know something and it's like, oh, you're thinking about it all the time. So I think Jeffrey was right as far as like, oh, if you read this, if you know this, the way your life is right now, you will not look at these people the same way, you will not adjust the same way. So I think he had to do it.
Yeah. Not to mention the fact that you got to think about point of views. From Will's perspective is he doesn't know that much. All he's known is, okay, his aunt Vi talked about it, and then no one else talks about it. So, of course, he wouldn't know how Uncle Phil really feels about it or just how deep this whole family thing really goes. All you know is Aunt Vi was just mentioned a few times. Yeah. So now he's interested. So on Jeffrey's part, I don't feel like it was a betrayal. Or on Will's part, I definitely don't feel like it's a betrayal, because a betrayal means you know about, like, beforehand. And from him, it's just like, oh, shit, who's my father really is, and is it worth knowing? So I think the warning was very fair and very kind of deserved, because Jeffrey, again, he's a bone collector. He knows all these secrets. He knows how deep these kind of ties will go and how deep these relationships go. So I think that was his, like, easiest way of just saying, okay, I'm going to give it to you, but don't say I didn't warn you. Mm-hmm. So he could, like, dang, I did my due diligence. Like, I wasn't the bad guy in the situation. And if you come Uncle Phil kind of any type of way, like, don't act like I didn't tell you. So I think that was his way of just, like, playing it clean and just still try to come off as clean as possible. But unfortunately, you saw Uncle Phil's reaction. That didn't mean shit. The moment he gave the papers, he could have said anything. It wouldn't matter. He's already made him ops.
Man, that was sad to see, man. The brotherhood is falling apart. Phil got to chill with that. You work for me. Phil got to chill with that. You don't tell your fixer you work for me. He knows too much information for he to be on your bad side.
I was about to say, you can't say something like that on this guy who knows your every secret. Yeah,
come on
this
now.
This is 12 years of Bel-Air. Like, nah.
You work for me now. Nah. Phil, he's like very arrogant sometimes, and he's gonna bite him, and is already has came back to bite him. But
again, that's why Jeffrey's the only one. Well, Jeffrey and Viv are the only ones who really can call him out on that.
All right, cool. Let's talk a little bit about predictions. Obviously, there's one more episode this season, and then we've
one got more left. Season.
So, what do we think is gonna happen? Obviously, I've not read the synopsis, so I don't know what's coming up, you know, from what the synopsis says, but. What do you think is going to happen this last episode?
I don't know. I just don't know how this show could spin Will's father being not as important, but as shocking as it's making out to be. Because we know they keep calling him Will. So we know
was his name on the previous show.
Yeah. So we know it's not like a character we've maybe seen our lives. We know it's not Phil or, you know, Jeffrey, because like they calling him a separate person. So I'm really curious, like, who, what he did, what's going to happen. But I think that's obviously going to be the catalyst of the finale, as Will's father and what to go from there. I don't know. I really don't know who it could be. I haven't read the synopsis. I know people on Reddit are speculating right now. I haven't read the spoilers. But I'm curious to see also how they're going to lead into season two. Like, what's the cliffhanger? Are they going to do a season where it wraps up in a way that, like, this could stand on its own? Or is it going to be like, yeah, we need season two to kind of continue, like, closure on everyone's story. So I really don't know what way it could go. Like, I don't even know if I even have any predictions. Like, I'm totally in the dark. Like, I assume him and Lisa will work things out. I assume Jeffrey will come back, or, you know, be in the finale. And then obviously I'll be able to take the job, but I don't know.
I feel like it's going to be, I feel like Aunt Viv is definitely going to take the job, no doubt about it. If Aunt Viv don't take the job, it's definitely going to cause, like, big ruptures in the family.
Yeah, right.
That, like, keep us satisfied until season two comes. I feel Lou's definitely coming back. There's no way. You can't just mention all this while showing at least a hint of Lou in the season finale. For the Lisa thing, I think with Phil leaving the race, I feel like that's going to make a little better, but Lisa's probably gonna be side-eyeing Will the whole time, just like, well, if you're hiding from me, I told you everything and you didn't tell me this. So, but that's the biggest thing I have. It's kind of the biggest thing Gyasi also has. You can't do all this, talk about what type of man your father, like, it has to be something big.
Yeah.
I think they had like dramatic moments on the show. I feel like it's going to be dramatic, but not like too dramatic. It's worth all this kind of secrets that it has to be something really balls off. It feels like, dang, I'm firing you, Jeffrey, because like of this secret. Like, it, like, damn, you can't hype this up and just have some anticlimactic stuff, because that's going to make me heat.
Yeah, it is. I don't know. Dave, what you got? Like, what's up with Will's father, man? Just go ahead and tell us.
Well, what if you was Rashad's brother?
What's that?
What Rashad's brother?
Yeah, I know, oh right? My gosh. I think Will's father is going to be Chris Rock, or the character will be played by Chris Rock. That'll be perfect. And he's going to come on there, and Phil's going to slap him
for
being outside of, for showing up and being out. No, I don't
know. Oh, yeah, Will's father is actually Jada Pinkett Smith.
Yeah, right. Yeah, they sure. Why not?
Okay.
Anything can happen, right? Anything goes in this world.
Anything can happen in Bel-Air.
This is a progressive, new age, you know, choose your identity type of world. So so here's what's going to happen. So I think Lou is going to show up like the last 5 minutes of the last episode of this episode, right? It's just going to be a stinger at the end, kind of like that. You know, everything, the episode is going to end. Everybody's going to be happy. You know, Lisa's going to come back into the fold. Jeffrey's going to come back into the fold. We're all going to be one big happy family. And then it's going to be knock, 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 open the door. Hey, son. And that's going to how they're going to end the season, right? The last thing will be Lou. And they'll end it on that. I think Ashley's going to come out to her mom. I think she's going to, you know, reveal the truth. This episode, next episode, I think, I don't see Carlton relapsing next episode. Yeah, no. I think that would be a season two thing. I think they're not going to completely destroy what he's established in one episode. I think there's going to be something where, you know, he comes to bat for Will, like really hard, and gets him back with Lisa. I think, you know, he's going to be the catalyst to, you know, kind of mend that relationship. Viv's going to accept the art scholarship thing, and then we'll see some development of that, and I don't know how it's going to go, you know. Because that would be a next season thing where they follow her going through the art scholarship. They wouldn't, you know, she'll just accept it, and maybe she'll be like happy and elated to kind of get back into the world, but maybe feel like, oh man, this is going to be a lot, you know. She's starting to kind of like, oh man, what did I get myself into? I bit off more than I can chew, you know, type thing. I think we'll get hints of that, maybe, or lay the groundwork for what could happen. Hill, I mean, they didn't really talk about, like was she talking about something she might be doing in the future? I thought they laid the groundwork for something she could potentially be doing internet wise. I can't remember what it was.
And I don't remember what it is either, but they didn't hint that like she could start a business or something.
Yeah. So whatever they mentioned Hill might do last episode, she's going to start doing.
She's going to do it.
She'll start developing some following or something.
Based off that reaction with one of the friends at the church, where she was trying to say, yo, let's collaborate on something. I feel like I feel like the sexy chef will have
that Karrueche.
It might be Karrueche.
Feel like that was her.
Phil will just sit at his desk and twiddle his thumbs for the entire episode because now he has nothing to do.
Yeah, like I was gonna ask, what do you guys think Phil's character would do in season two? Where are you gonna go with that?
I don't know. Maybe they'll just show him as a lawyer, right? Because we haven't even seen that yet. Maybe he'll go and take on some big case, you know? That would be interesting for the whole season.
Or maybe, like, it's probably his relationship with Judge Robinson, just probably beef that makes him go on that whole, I'm going to judge now.
Yeah.
Self-sabotaging Judge Robinson. Feeling to throw himself under the bus just to make sure Phil doesn't succeed.
That's right. Phil's going to go find Rashid. They're going to hang out and...
Oh my god!
No more unity. Yeah. Rashad, Phil teaming up.
Yeah. That's pretty much all I can think of. I think we've hit on all the main characters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you think Lisa will forgive, or that Lisa and Will get back together in the next episode, or that's going to be a next season thing?
They better
get back next episode.
I feel like I don't want to see this dragged on too long. We know she's going to forgive eventually, and it wasn't that big of a deal.
Okay. Just get on with it. Yeah. You two kids make up.
Exactly. Like, get it. Either do or don't. Like, don't waste no time. But I feel like Luke coming back might have a little help. Like, dang, my father's here. I need someone cuddle.
I just looked it up, and that was Karrueche Tran on that last episode. And it also says she's joined the cast. So I feel like she's going to be a big part of season two.
Cool.
Karrueche on Bel-Air? Damn, Chris Brown's definitely not going to watch this.
Oh my God.
I was looking up on the old show, Viv and Vi, there are two other sisters. So plenty of cameo opportunities there. Yeah, there were actually four sisters.
There's four sisters, the divas.
Yeah. You know, actually, we saw two cameos this last episode. Who's going to cameo next? Who's your prediction for the next cameo? Either Carlton, the original Carlton, or maybe original Jeffrey?
I think original Jeffrey. I saw a picture of him with the new Jeffrey.
Oh, okay.
A couple days ago. So I feel like, and they're actually friends in real life. The British actress.
They should bring the original Jeffrey as the replacement for Jeffrey.
Oh my God.
I hired this new butler. His name is Robert or something.
That'd be funny.
I'm gonna call it. I feel like Big Will Smith is gonna come in like the ultimate passing of the torch.
I don't think so. I don't know.
Maybe season two.
So huge. Yeah. That would be crazy. I mean, Will Smith has not appeared in a TV show in like 12 years. I mean, I understand this is his show, but I don't know how it happens.
I wouldn't put it past him showing up at some point, but that's like a Hail Mary, we need to save the show type thing.
Yeah.
You know,
but we could be wrong. Maybe the praise is bad. We'll see. We'll see tomorrow. Oh, not tomorrow, but Thursday.
Yeah. You know, I mean, obviously it's not directly related to the show, but do you think this whole slap thing will have a potential negative impact on the show going forward, or its ratings, or potential future season? We know it's already been approved for a second season, but do you think there'll be any fallout from this Will Smith slapping thing that could affect the show?
I would have to say no.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at a lot of the stuff has occurred at the Oscar, people have been honored that have done some shady things. So I think, right. I mean, Will Smith issued his apology. I think he's going to be on a red table talk any day now, going in with Jada talking about how painful it was for him. I think Chris Rock is obviously, I think Sean Diddy or P. Diddy Combs just said like that they talk their family. He said they talk and they know their family. So I don't know. I don't think it's going to affect this show in particular. I mean, obviously Will's reputation took a hit, but I couldn't imagine affecting Bel-Air.
It may not affect the show, but I think it would affect his guest appearing on the show, right?
Oh, yeah.
If he was not already scheduled to appear in episode 10, I think any plans to maybe include him in season two would probably be put on hold till maybe season three after this blows over or last, you know, give some time, you know?
Yeah.
Because he wouldn't want to distract from the show's success.
Yeah. That's a good point.
I think he'd be a distraction. But
I think the biggest thing about was, I feel like it's not going to do no damage to the show, but it's more on like Will's career presently. But again, after he did a snap, he just got Oscar, like no ramifications. So I don't feel like it's going to have any long-term ramifications on the show itself.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. All right, guys. Well, is there anything else you want to add before we sign off from this week's episode?
Man, one more left.
Yeah.
One more hoorah. Let's see how it goes.
Big Bel-Air party.
That's right.
And hopefully Coco Jones will like come on the show one day.
We should all fly to Bel-Air and watch the finale in Bel-Air.
They love. Jazzy's gonna pay for tickets.
I'll pay for drinks.
I'll pay the tip on those drinks.
Okay, that and Bala, you got the tickets.
Nolan got the tickets. I got the tap.
You, me, Nolan, Jossie, Dave, Son, everybody would just pitch in a couple bucks.
Yeah,
for everything. No, well, I mean, well, we could, you know, I mean, you and me, us three could at least get together in person if you want to do an in-person watch party
of the last episode. We could for the finale. We could.
And then we pipe in Nolan and we pipe in Dave and Hassan, whoever, you know, come in and, you know, do that. Like, if you guys want to do that, if that's something you're interested in.
That could be fine.
Okay.
That's awesome. We could talk about, like, yo, that might be the move.
It'll be BYOB. I'll bring some snacks.
Okay, cool.
All right, guys. Well, throw out your social info and we'll call it a night.
Yeah. If you guys want to talk to me more about Bel-Air, definitely catch me on Instagram and Twitter, Little Gyasi, LilGyasi.
And you know it is like DMV Zone, Bala. You can catch me on Twitter, Big Bala Brand 24. That's 2 L's. Then you can also catch my IG, Bala_Bala23. And you can catch me on Reddit, Mike2975A.
Awesome. All right. You can find me on the subreddit, reddit.com/r/Bel-Air. And follow all the conversations and topics. Let us know if you agree or disagree with what we talked about here tonight. And look forward to catching that last episode of the season. And then it's going to be a long, dark, blank spot until the next season. But, you know, we'll make do with some stuff in between. Hopefully get some characters from the show and get some, you know, people built the show. I'd love to have a rotating group of people who had association with the show to talk about it. So we'll see if that happens. But
and also get some people involved when the show on here we can find.
Well, I mean, I'd be happy. I was actually thinking of like scouring the credits.
Yeah.
And like finding, oh, okay, let's get the grip. You know, let's get the lighting guys from the show. You know, because they all probably have stories from the set, you know,
yeah,
they might be able to tell, right?
So I feel like it's not be far-fetched. Like we can get someone involved with the show, definitely just interview them, talk about the process.
Yeah. I mean, the guy who played Jazz went on somebody's YouTube channel and the dude had like a couple hundred subscribers, you know? So if they're willing to do that for him, you know, I'm sure he'd be willing to take time out to talk to us, you know?
Yeah, it'd be fun.
We hope. Awesome. Like, yo, speak in the air. You never know.
And maybe you guys with your production connections and all that stuff.
Yeah, get some
Hollywood connections can get those people.
Wait, Johnson, you said you lived around like Jabari Banks, so you know, who knows?
Yeah, we got a lot of mutual followers. Send some DMs out.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, thanks so much for your time. This has been Saved by the Bell, the Bel-Air After Show. I've been your host, David J. Murphy, and we will see you next week for episode 10. Good night, everybody.
See y'all.